On Friday, a court in Cincinnati ruled that the grandparents of a 17-year-old transgender teen would receive custody of him over the parents. The judge stated that the child will be placed with them, who accept the teen for who he is, and that with the ruling comes certain conditions. Now, before the teen can seek hormone therapy or any transitional procedure, they must undergo a psychiatric evaluation, which will focus on the teen's gender presentation and feelings of nonconformity. The evaluation must not be affiliated with Cincinnati Children's Hospital, which houses a transgender health clinic, and where the teen first went to seek treatment for depression and anxiety, and received a diagnosis for gender dysphoria back in 2016. What we should ask ourselves about this case is, to what extent should the state be allowed to overrule a child's legal guardians in determining what's best for children? While I believe the state should intervene in cases of child abuse and neglect, there is a slippery slope presented when it's considered abuse by the state for parents to wait on giving their children hormones or puberty blockers and instead opting for more mental health treatment for the child. Now, it must be noted that with this case, the parents' decision to wait on giving their child hormones was not the only abuse that was perceived by the state. According to court documents, the teen reported that he once had to sit in a room and listen to Bible scriptures for 6 hours at a time. It's unfortunate that this case involved abuse, as it will serve as an example for future cases involving the custody of transgender children. The judge even noted that, as this is likely to occur again, it sets legal precedent. On calling for new legislation, Judge Hendon stated, "That type of legislation would give a voice and a pathway to youth similarly situated," she said, without attributing fault to the parents and involving them in protracted litigation, which can and does destroy the family unit. Because the case ruled the state can decide the fate of a minor and remove a child from their parents, the slippery slope occurs when there is no sign of abuse, when a child can simply declare, "I am transgender, therefore by law, regardless of my mental state, I can start transitioning, or leave my parents' house and go live with someone else." Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't say the slippery slope is a logical fallacy, but only because it doesn't necessarily occur. Do I believe that all children will be granted the right to medically transition if they claim they are transgender? No, but a few might. And it's those few that is worth considering how we look at two things. Number one, at what point is a child allowed to exercise control over a parent's knowledge of what is best for them? In this case, the teen was 17 years old, basically an adult. But what if the child was 13 years old or 11 years old? Does a 13-year-old have the same decision-making faculties as an adult? I say no. In fact, I'd even argue that a 17-year-old does not possess the foresight to make a decision about medically transitioning and that the parents do know best. Number two, at what point can the state legally enforce or deny the wishes of the child or the parents? Looking back at the Ohio case, we get a grasp of how hard this is to determine. While I believe a 17-year-old is better at making this type of decision as a 13-year-old, we should not overlook their mental state. The teen's grandparents stated he would commit suicide if he was not allowed to be given hormones, and that the case should be resolved quickly so that the teen might transition as soon as possible and not harm themselves. However, research has shown that transgender people who go through the process of transitioning do not show a decrease in suicidal behavior. Many retain any mental illness they had before transitioning, and when 41% of the transgender community attempts suicide at least once in their lifetime, this might be worth noting before pursuing a permanent medical method in treating gender dysphoria. Even celebrities that have pushed a transgender narrative that accepts transgender identity without question can't ignore these realities. Recently, sources close to Caitlyn Jenner report that she regrets transitioning, is still dealing with depression, and sometime in the future plans on detransitioning. People are often pushed towards transitioning as a way to not only solve gender dysphoria, but other mental illness as well, which is why I was glad in this case, the judge specifically said that the transgender teen must receive a psychiatric evaluation independent from that Cincinnati hospital. That diagnosis rather quickly became one of gender dysphoria, Hendon said, adding she was concerned that the director of the hospital's transgender health clinic said 100% of patients seen by the clinic who present for care are considered to be appropriate candidates for continued gender treatment. Allowing 100% of patients into this program might be compassionate and accepting, but it doesn't mean it's medically sound and good for the overall health of the patient. While I support the freedom of anyone to make decisions about their gender, this comes with the expectation that they are both mature enough and mentally stable to make a decision that can affect them the rest of their lives. In the case of children, they are not mature enough, and if the child has anxiety or depression, are clearly not in a good mental state. While the state should intervene in cases of neglect and abuse, it should never usurp the role of a parent in caring for their children. It should also not declare that a parent waiting to give their child hormones is abuse, because our culture now sees it as unaccepted or bigoted. Listen, I'm not saying 9-year-olds will be taken by the state from their abusive parents who won't let them start immediately transitioning, but I'm also not saying it couldn't happen. Personally, if the state and medical community tried to convince me that they knew what was best for my 9-year-old's mental health by requesting I relinquish my child so that they might start transitioning immediately, I imagine I'd react like most parents.
Get off my lawn.
The legal precedent has been set. Now the question that remains is, how much more power should we give to the state in the future? Hey, thanks for watching. If you want to help support this channel, please share the video and start a discussion in the comments below or over on Twitter at MyHeroTruth.